brothers and sisters, and friends, and I see some enemies. In fact, I think we'd be fooling ourselves if we had an audience this large and didn't realize that there were some enemies present.
I wanted to make this video today to go over three things that I hear cop watchers say. I want to address these three things because I hear a lot of cop watchers saying these things. And I just want to go over them. And I guess the purpose of this is to change the way cop watchers interact with the cops out there. So those three things that I want to address are... Oh shit, we got a cop. 7 o'clock. All right, so those three things are rights, you know, that you got rights, you got constitutional rights. The issue of upholding their oaths, right? When you hear cop watchers say that, you know, you swore an oath to protect and serve the Constitution. And the third thing is the issue of citizens. And I guess I'm going to question whether or not they really exist. All right, so with that being said, let's get started.
Rights. Boy, everyone in this country's always running around yammering about their fucking rights. I have a right, you have no right, we have a right, they don't have a right. Folks, I hate to spoil your fun, but there's no such thing as rights, okay? They're imaginary. We made them up, like the boogeyman. The three little pigs, Pinocchio, Mother Goose, shit like that. Rights are an idea. They're just imaginary. They're a cute idea. Cute. But that's all. Cute and fictional. But if you think you do have rights, let me ask you this. Where do they come from? People say, well, they come from God. They're God-given rights. Oh, fuck. Here we go again. Doesn't sound like divine planning to me. Sounds more like human planning. Sounds more like one group trying to control another group. In other words, business as usual in America. Now, they're privileges. That's all we've ever had in this country is a bill of temporary privileges. Yeah. Sooner or later, the people in this country are going to realize the government does not give a fuck about them. Government doesn't care about you or your children or your rights or your welfare or your safety. It simply doesn't give a fuck about you. It's interested in its own power. That's the only thing, keeping it and expanding it wherever possible.
There is no such thing as constitutional rights. I'm going to say that again so that you can quote me exactly right on that. There is no such thing as constitutional rights. Now, all you guys out there with cameras filming cops, doing your First Amendment test or whatever you want to call it, get your facts straight. The Bill of Rights was actually the first 10 amendments that were added onto the Constitution in 1791. It was added because of two different ways in which the Constitution itself was interpreted. One being the Federalist point of view, the other being the Anti-Federalist point of view. Federalists look at it like the Constitution limits the power of the government, while the anti-federalists view it as granting power to the government.
To have maybe an educated opinion about it, we have to look at some of the other ideas that we've inherited, you know. Like, it seems natural for anarchists to be pro-gun, because we understand that there are no such thing as rights, right? There's only what you negotiate. The idea of rights, who gave us this idea that there's rights?
Yeah.
That there's a package of benefits that you just get. Who gave us that idea? There's not. That's an illusion. Think about it that way. There are no rights. There's only what you negotiate. And when you're negotiating with people in voluntary relationships, you have to come with by adding value. And when you're negotiating with gangs, even really organized gangs that all wear the same color clothing and have insignias that they all belong to the same gang.
Yeah.
And they all have guns. And they come to the negotiation not with words, not with pieces of paper that are promises. They come to the negotiation with guns. And a lot of times, they act to take away your right to your body, your right to your product, or your right to your free movement. So these are the three aspects of the self. Your present, your future, and your past self, right?
Yeah.
Your body, your movement, and your product, like things that you spent labor or time on yesterday in order to acquire, right?
Yeah.
So how do you negotiate with these people? Because there's no rights. There's only what you negotiate. So although I am all for peace, and I seek to contribute to a society that generates peace because it's just, and it's just because it's voluntary, right? I recognize that we don't yet live in that society. And just like every eagle has claws and every gazelle has horns and the ability to run away from its predators, and every animal on earth has some kind of a mechanism or apparatus to defend itself, right?
Yeah.
I think that humans should not be the only animal that gives away its ability to defend itself to its only predators, which would be other humans.
All right, so the oaths that cops or any other person in government take to support and uphold the Constitution have no validity or obligation. And why? They are given to nobody. There was no mutual recognition, consent, or agreement between the people taking the oaths, meaning the cops, and those who they're swearing the oath to. On that alone, it can be said that there is no contract or pledge of faith legally. At best, people swearing an oath to support the Constitution can say they swore it to no one. If a cop watcher tells a cop on the streets that he's one of the people that the Constitution said to protect, that cop can legitimately say, "I don't know you, you weren't there when I took this oath, I didn't take this oath to you, go kick rocks." Cop watchers aren't even asked, nobody's asked, if this cop or that cop, if they wanted to even swear to support the Constitution. Can any cop watcher say that he has evidence to prove that this cop or that cop has any obligation to him or her? Do they have any evidence, written or otherwise, that proves that the cop to be his agent or representative, or given any of these cops written power of attorney? No. If any cop did fail to fulfill his oath, it is none of our business, as we cannot prove that the cop failed us individually. Period. End of story.
Law enforcement does not have a constitutional duty to protect you. This is something that has been established by the U.S. Supreme Court and other courts time after time. These courts have dealt with lawsuits where people have tried to sue law enforcement for failing to protect them, but they lost. If you don't understand it, or if you don't believe me, simply Google Warren versus D.C. Google Castle Rock versus Gonzalez. In 1999, Jessica Gonzalez actually filed a restraining order against her husband. She wanted the police to find and arrest her estranged husband. Well, the guy took their three kids. Eventually, he ended up killing their kids, and she tried to sue the police department. Well, she lost in the U.S. Court of Appeals in the 10th Circuit, and then she pressed it to the Supreme Court and lost again. Law enforcement does not have a constitutional duty to protect you. Some people think that, well, you shouldn't be able to own this gun or that gun because the police will protect you. Let me explain something to you. If you call 911, the average response time will be somewhere between 8 and 15 minutes, maybe 8 or 10 minutes or so, maybe 5 or 6 minutes if you're lucky. FBI data shows that about 25% of the violent crime calls are responded to within 5 minutes on average. So even the police can get there within, I don't know, 2 or 3 minutes. They're still not responsible for your safety, but it is not their constitutional duty to do so. It is your responsibility to do so. It says to serve and protect on the police cars. And they choose to protect you when they can, but it is not their constitutional duty to do so. 911 cannot save you, and whether you survive depends on you. You are responsible for your own safety.
Did they actually ever teach you in school what a citizen was? Anyone? Bueller? Anyone? But they never actually get into the concept that it's so important about what a citizen is in states, and they tell you about the states and the revolution, and they had this, and the colonies went to states, and they did all this. But did they ever tell you what a state really was? Anyone? Well, that's like we're talking about the indirect teaching. They don't teach you what it is. They teach you what to do. One thing you can do, that I'm going to do is show you, is that unlike with the religious aspect, I'm going to use empirical evidence and absolutely prove without any, beyond all doubt whatsoever, that there's no such thing as a citizen or a state. And it doesn't even take that long. All it is, like I say on the book, it's public relations to keep you paying taxes. That's all it is. To keep you in line, like what those ants outnumber us, at least 100 to 1. And if they ever figure it out, there goes our way of life. It's not about the food. It's about keeping you ants in line. As long as you think that you're a citizen or resident of a non-existent state, you're going to continue paying taxes. Right? Pretty much. So let's deconstruct that. Is the state, let's see, state of Arizona, was there a state of Arizona prior to February of 1912? So the answer is no, right? Was the land of Arizona there? So is Arizona different from the state of Arizona? Heck yes. I've even had a federal judge, not a federal judge, she was a municipal judge, Paula Burgess. You can look her up online. She still is a pro tem judge in Mesa. She told the truth when it came to the state. Very rare. So right at the very beginning, I'm taking judicial notice that the state of Arizona is an act of Congress. The state of Arizona is an act of Congress signed by the president. It's a piece of paper. So I said, oh, great. We don't need a trial unless you can tell me that you have a witness to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that I was within that act of Congress on this day. All right, so let's get back. All right, let's look at it from a legal standpoint and see if we can see if there's any evidence. We know it's an act of Congress. Let's look at what a citizen is supposed to be. Something they didn't teach you in any of these schools. A citizen, and I'm not pulling this out of thin air. It's Loria versus United States. I don't know the actual citation, but it's in the book. I thought maybe you'd have it. Anyway, it's Loria versus United States. It's the United States Supreme Court, and they define a citizen legally as a member of the body politic owing a duty of allegiance in return for a duty of protection. These are reciprocal obligations, one a consideration for the other. Okay, let's break that down just a little bit. Okay, now, is anyone familiar with this relationship between allegiance and protection? Does this sound familiar to anybody? It's a fealty. It's an oath of fealty. It's an oath of allegiance. You know, when someone gets naturalized, what do they have to do? They have to put the hand to the square and swear an oath of allegiance. So it's the old English common law thing that allegiance draws with it protection, protection draws with it allegiance. Right? Now, we'll go through, I want to go through, so legally there's no citizen, and just morally or economically there are no citizens. How did the duty of allegiance and the duty of protection arise? Well, let's look at it. Are taxes compulsory or are they voluntary?
Compulsory.
So, could someone really have a duty to protect you if it's compulsory? Someone said Al Capone before, right?
Yeah.
So, if Al Capone was getting protection money from speakeasy, was he obligated to protect them? Well, of course not. It's all by violence. It's all compulsory. That's why I mentioned before, all I should have to say is, well, the means are not consistent with the end. There couldn't be of a duty to protect, even legally or even economically. Well, let's look at it legally. Legally, does the government have any duty to protect anybody in the state?
No.
How do we know this?
Supreme Courts.
Is it just one Supreme Court that said that?
No, several.
Every Supreme Court has said that. Because if they had a duty to protect you, now let's look at LA for example. If they had a duty to protect you, wouldn't that be actionable when they didn't and your car was stolen or your house was broken into or someone breaks into your car this afternoon and takes your iPod? It would be actionable. If you did sue them, and many people have, this is how I know this stuff. If you did sue, let's say you sued the city of LA for not protecting you because you were mugged, what would a battery of attorneys, that's a scary thought, what would a battery of attorneys file in response to your complaint? They file a demur here in California, and they would say you failed to state a claim upon which relief can be granted, you have no cause of action because you did not state a case. The government has no duty to protect you, and they've told us that. There are many, many Supreme Court cases where the Supreme Court of the United States in DeShaney versus County of Winnebago, which is one of many, many cases, that the government is under absolutely no duty to protect anybody. So if you look in the government code here in California, I think it's section 945, but don't quote me on that. It is in the government code that you cannot hold the government responsible for failing to provide police protection. So that's why I put in my videos that when, and I overlay that, Salazar versus City of Antioch is where the California Court of Appeals, which the Supreme Court did not review because it didn't disagree with it, where the Court of Appeals stated, this is a direct quote, police officers have no statutory duty to do anything. So they tell us legally, and we know that the fact that taxes are compulsory, no duty to protect us could be created. So what does that mean? What are the implications of that? This hit me years ago, because I had gotten into all this stuff about citizens. Well, citizens are a member of the body politic, duty of allegiance in return for protection. But there's no duty to protect anybody. What does that mean about allegiance? Does anybody owe allegiance? No! So if you don't have a duty of allegiance, you don't have a duty of protection, are there any citizens?
No!
No. Okay, and that's in the Constitution, right? And the Constitution is what? No, that's an opinion. Tell me what it is factually. Thank you. That's the answer. Did anyone sign it? Did anyone sign it in any manner as a signatory or to make themselves responsible to it as an agreement?
No.
So it's just a piece of paper. They said, if you read it, it says what? In witness thereof. Nobody signed it in any manner that it could be binding as an agreement. As Lysander Spooner wrote in Constitution, no authority, no treason, the Constitution has no inherent authority. If it has any authority at all, it's as a contract, and it doesn't even purport to be a contract. And even if we accepted it, I'm going to paraphrase a little now, even if we accepted it as a contract, which no court in the country, so-called, would ever enforce the contract, the Constitution as a contract, if you did accept it as a contract, it only applied to anybody who agreed to it then, in 1787. We'll just say, well, they signed it, we'll just assume they signed it to make themselves responsible. So only the people who actually signed it could be held responsible to its terms. They're all dead. So the Constitution doesn't help because there's no connection. It's just a piece of paper. Because if I said this piece of paper gave me a right to your house, you'd rightly, tell me where to go. You seem to think that these four pieces of paper in Washington, D.C. that no one gets to even look at, touch, you seem to think that gives you a right to my house. Raving nonsense. So we show that we can show empirically that there are no citizens. So if there are no citizens, is there a body politic?
No.
So if we don't have a body politic, is there a state?
No.
Well, if you have no states, is there a United States?
No.
Here's a tough one. If you don't have a state, and you don't have citizens, is there a government?
No.
So what do you have?
Individuals.
Guys with guns. This is why I define government, and we can prove this, nothing more than a group of men and women providing a service on a compulsory basis. And a service that they don't even have to provide, right? So we see that the concept of a state is absolutely false, empirically false. We can prove this. We can actually prove this. But that is taking apart the concept of a state.
As these days go by, I am consumed more and more with the struggle that we're all in. It should be clear to any cop watcher listening that the people that call themselves government have openly declared war on anyone who dares challenge their power. And I said power because they have no authority. Not only are they willing to kill anyone, but they're willing to kill their own as well. Over the years, the government has become more organized and prepared to deal with people like us. We have put ourselves at a huge disadvantage by delaying our own organization and preparedness. I hope this video has opened up some eyes. Please share, like, or subscribe. I'll finish with Mark Stevens correctly pointing out our collective fear. Thanks.
Because I think deep down, people know government's the problem. But we know government's the problem. But we don't know how everyone else is going to respond to that. We don't know how you're going to react to that. We don't know if you believe that. So the tragedy is, we all know the government has to be abolished as soon as society is ready for it, but we don't stand up and do anything about it because we don't think you believe it, or you or anyone. You imagine that we all want it abolished as soon as possible, but we're not brave enough or confident enough to stand up and do what's right.